Someone once said, the trouble with our times is that the future is not what it used to be. You know, it seems hard to believe that only 50 years ago the Columbia River was a free-flowing river along with its tributaries, with rapids. It's hard to believe that it was only 40 years ago that we had the last major devastating flood on the Columbia River. We now have a river which appears to be totally under control, producing lots of electricity, navigational benefits, recreational benefits, but with tremendous ecological effect, much of which even today may not be known for decades to come. But what of the next 50 years? We've certainly found out that the demand for electricity is as hard to predict as interest rates or the stock market. What is going to happen to our river? Our two speakers today are Oregon's representative to a group that spend full time thinking about the next 50 years on the Columbia River and its tributaries. 8 years after its formation, the Nortwhest Power Planning Council appears to be well on its way to becoming a Nortwhest institution. The regional debate over the role of the council has receded somewhat, I think, to be replaced, and appropriately replaced, with debate focused on the issues before the council. The council was created just 8 years ago when the states of Idaho, Montana, Oregon, and Washington entered into a compact to address certain specific resources all four states share. The bond that linked these states, of course, is the 1,200-mile-long Columbia River and its tributaries, which flow through the Northwest like life-giving arteries. These rivers are the nation's most prolific producers of hydroelectric power, providing relatively inexpensive energy that is one of the cornerstones of the Northwest economy. The rivers and their banks are also home to important biological resources, salmon and steelhead and other fish species, as well as a tremendously varied stock of wildlife. Unfortunately, the development of electricity and the survival of the creatures of the river basin often conflict. Each affects the other. It is the council's role to strike a balance between them. Our two speakers today, Oregon's members of the council, are both longtime public servants in the state of Oregon. Norma Paulus is a Salem, Oregon lawyer. She served as Secretary of State in Oregon from 1977 to 1985. When elected in 1976, Norma was the first woman in Oregon history to win a statewide election. In 1986, she was her party's nominee for state governor. From 1971 to 1977, she represented Marion County for three terms in the Oregon legislature. She's an appellate lawyer. She was an appellate lawyer before entering public service. Our other speaker, who will speak first, is Ted Hallock. Ted was an Oregon State Senator for 20 years, from 1963 to 1983. During this period, he served as Senate Majority Leader and as Chairman of the Senate Committees on Energy and the Environment, Land Use, Human Resources, and Housing. His legislative activities focused on statewide land use planning, environmental quality, tax reform, and health care. He co-authored Oregon's innovative 1973 land use bill. In addition, he has operated a public relations firm in Portland since 1959, and as all of you know, owns one of radio's most famous golden voices. Please welcome Ted Hallock, our first speaker, and he'll be followed by Norma Paulus.
I'm the newest member of the council, having been named in June, and know virtually nothing about the topic, but that doesn't make me unique at all among previous City Club speakers. I only bring that up so that when Greg Cafoy arises to offer his traditional 17-minute long question, my answer will be, you're probably right at that, Greg. One of my favorite pieces of reading is the newsletter that Arnold Biskar produces. He's the very excellent CPA in Portland, former county commissioner, and I'm reading from the current issue some of the gems. This is in the bathroom reading is what it is, but one of the best quotes in the latest issue is, "Lead me not into temptation, I can find the way myself." That's from Rita Mae Brown, and a good one from Edna St. Vincent Millay: "It is not true that life is one damn thing after another, it's one damn thing over and over again." In that issue, however, I'm indebted to him because I didn't know what to talk about here. The Chinese word for crisis is composed of two picture characters, the one meaning danger and the other meaning opportunity. And I called David Chen of the Farmers Home Loan Administration, who speaks Mandarin, to give me the words so I could make a better story, but he's too busy finding out from the Bush administration when he'll be fired, so he's in Washington. But this is the energy part of the picture. As Phyllis said, we're eight human beings on the council, really lay people in the strictest sense of the word. We've had legislative experience, some of us, which stands us, I guess, in good stead. It is in my original invitation, I was asked to comment on the council and service on the council per se, and it makes my legislative 20 years seem like a Boy Scout rehearsal, because on the council with eight players, if you cough wrong, you've alienated two. It's an extraordinary experience in group dynamics. I am thrilled about one aspect of it. I have both been named by and serve with currently I think the two most innovative people in the state of Oregon, Neil Goldschmidt and Norma Paulus. And I looked forward with a little trepidation to serving with her, A, because she's a little feisty, and B, because she's a Republican, although some of my best friends are Republicans, don't misunderstand me. But she is simply fabulous in her grasp of the entire concept, and I am pleased to recall that when she and I served in the House of Representatives together, the original solar-oriented legislation for solar easements, solar rights of way, and so forth, which was likewise avant-garde in the United States, emerged under the aegis of Norma Paulus and Ted Hallock. It's nice to be reunited. Back to the Chinese word, we're confronted. The council divides itself into what's called the Power Committee and the Fish Committee. I'm on the Power Committee, she's on the Fish Committee. And the problem is this. The council was formed when we had a great surplus of power. We were wallowing in electric power and brandishing our electric toothbrushes as though there was no end to the good stuff of life. When there was the exact opposite, there was a shortage. Now today we are brandishing those toothbrushes, and yet we're headed right back for, we think, an electrical power crunch. It's been difficult to get anybody's attention because we are so energy affluent. Oil is at $10 a barrel, and or $12 or $14, going toward $10, and so forth. So we have quite a problem. We have a temporary, we think, surplus, and yet we're headed toward, we think, a shortage. And what are we going to do about it? I was intrigued by the fact that you had a speaker here, Charles Ebinger, if I'm pronouncing his name correctly, for the from the U.S. Council for Energy Awareness. Well, about 3 months ago, a bunch of television spots began to appear, and that's my bag, television and radio advertising, and they began to tell us how neat everything was because we had coal and nuclear to rely on. In other words, I slept a lot better that night knowing that we had coal to rely on, which was destroying the planet through its emission of CO2 into the atmosphere, thereby contributing to the greenhouse effect, and thereby giving us about another century to survive. That was reassuring. And then to back that up, however, I was pleased to know that we had nuclear power that was doing so well in Hanford, leaching its effluent into the Columbia River, doing so well that the paragon of conservatism, the President of the United States, closed down all the weapons production outfits in the grounds that potentially they were possibly unsafe. Trojan, which I had opposed from the beginning, which is closed sporadically for safety violations or one thing or another. Chernobyl, which was a good experience, equaled only in its appeal by 3 Mile Island. It was reassuring to hear from this man that we had these power, and from these television spots, we had these sources to rely on. I called Peter DeFazio, the congressman from Eugene, and asked him, what is this outfit? What is this Council for Energy Awareness? And he said, it's pro-nuclear. But I read what Ebinger told you, and Ebinger said that as we move toward a cheaper oil, we'll be moving toward the temptation to use more small oil and gas-fired plants called combustion turbines. He's right. That will be a temptation. The Saudis will sell us $10 oil because OPEC doesn't know what it's doing, and the CTs will be spewing more CO2 into the air to compound the greenhouse effect. That was so he and I agree that is a prospect, and it's not too good a one. Then he went on. Mr. Ebinger's recommendations were that we try to keep oil imports down below 50% of total consumption to avoid building up this reliance upon foreign oil and, in my opinion, discharging more CO2 into the air. And then he said, push conservation in transportation through strict mileage standards for new cars. I'm thinking, bravo! Where are we going to get the punchline about nuclear power? Lowered speed limits, higher gas taxes, meaning a carbon tax, build more efficient appliances, and find cost-effective ways, he says, to build clean coal-fired electrical generating. At least he says clean. But it's interesting that this advocate of that dangerous, dangerous source of power, which in effect the state of Oregon and all of its people through plebiscites have said is persona non grata here, would concur with me that these are some of the challenges that we have to face. We had about a 2,500, we use some 17,000 megawatts of power here in the region. When I talk about the regions, Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Montana, we had about a 2,500 megawatt surplus of more power created than what we needed. About 87% of what we use is from hydro, when Phil was alluding to the river, the Columbia. That was about a year and a half ago or so. Now we're down about like this, to somewhere between 1,000, some say as low as 400 megawatts of surplus. And some disquieting things, they're salutary in an economic sense, are happening. Bonneville Power Administration, major, wheeler of power, distributor of power, if you please, is accelerating its sales of electrical power to California and other markets, which is contributing to this diminution of the surplus and contributing to the possibility that very soon we'll reach this zero level between supply and demand. In our opinion, we're going to get there sometime between next year and 1992 or 1993. And what are we going to do if we continue to grow even modestly? Now, in Oregon, we know, with no offense intended, Neil, that the energy comeback, the Oregon comeback has begun, but in terms of its achievement, it's probably, if it's going to move like this, it's right maybe about here. God willing, it will continue to climb. The aluminum industry is the classic example of what really high load growth means in terms of the council's interpretation. Prices of aluminum are through the ceiling. The pot lines are running full blast, and aluminum is a major consumer of power. It takes 1/6 of all of our power. Will this continue? Will our population burgeon? Will it even continue as it is? Will it decline? These are some of the things that we're having to cope with. But on the assumption there'll be a medium-high continued demand for power, where are we going to get it? How are we going to get it? Where is it going to come from? the council, largely through Ms. Paulus' efforts, passed in October a fantastic step, considering that the voters of Oregon followed it right up in November in designating more rivers as wild and scenic river systems. We created a protected area network of 43,000 miles of streams. I don't want to get into her speech, but it's relevant to mine, in which we said, no dams, no dams, no more kill the fish. We're going to return the fish runs to what they used to be. Well, having said that, that obviously affects where we can turn for more hydropower, our cheapest immediate source to date. There's some left, but what are we going to do? The first thing we got to do is to conserve. And it's a tremendously difficult message to here you are with the chandeliers ablaze, and again, your bathroom's probably got one or more electric toothbrushes or electric depilator things for women's legs or whatever the newest devices are to consume excess power. So we're swimming in electric power individually. It's not like Metro affecting solid waste, you know, out of sight, out of mind. As long as it's out of my garbage can, I don't give a goddamn where it goes. The first thing we've got to do is conservation. I am standing, which is really, this is a tremendous and enviable state and city. I am standing in the city which created the first energy plan, including energy conservation, in the United States of America, Portland, when Neil was the mayor. I'm standing in a city which has the Energy Conservation Incorporated, headed by Dolores Hurtado, funded through the city of Portland, through Mike Lindbergh's help and through Bud Clark's good offices and the rest, which is so much in demand for its expertise and has done such an excellent job in residential conservation and is now moving into commercial conservation that our local Dolores Hurtado people are now being retained by New England states who are in a deficit power situation to tell them about conservation. In terms of our similar expertise, our council's staff, our power council staff of 41, considered generally speaking the brightest and smartest group of young men and women in the nation, was avant-garde in leading the way in telling what least cost planning was. Least cost planning means if you can acquire a kilowatt hour for whatever it is, a mill or 2 mills, I'm not up on the figures yet, as I will be in time, but if you can acquire a cheap kilowatt hour to avoid building an extravagantly expensive coal-fired kilowatt hour or nuclear-fired kilowatt hour, you're smart to do so. We're now embarking, leading our region on least cost planning. One of our men, Jim Litchfield, was flown to London 60 days ago at the British expense to testify, I'm happy to say, against a nuclear plant. He wasn't per se testifying against nuclear, but he was pointing out to the British how least cost planning adoption would obviate the need to adopt this particular pending nuclear power plant. So we're leading the nation in terms of expertise, in terms of what to do. Now we've got to do it, however. We've got to do it. We've got to conserve. We're not conserving enough power in the construction of new homes, although Bonneville is leading the way in its super good sense programs, and I'm very much into retrofitting. We've got to look at alternative renewable energy sources. We've got to look seriously at geothermal. For example, there's a 50-megawatt hole near Crater Lake that's under debate environmentally before the BLM. There's another 50-megawatt hole near it. That's 100 megawatts of utilitarian geothermal. There's another hole in Bend that's productive, ready to bring in juice. We've got to look again at our wind farms that we got off to a bad start with in Hood River and Wasco County and in Coos and Curry County that we can do better with. We've got to look at tidal. OSU's got some marvelously experimental material and wind tanks that can show us what we, like Israel, is doing, could do with tidal power. And of course, with solar, it's obvious. Solar, the theoretically perpetual, unless we occlude the sun's graces with the greenhouse effect and the discharge of CO2, is here for us forever. So we've got to look at alternative and renewables. Finally, we have in the council the very mundane problem of helping Bonneville Power Administration exist. Bonneville underwrote, in effect, the whoops problem. Is that the most charitable way to say it? The reason I hate these speeches, they're televised, and then 15 minutes later I'm going to get hung by my own tongue by something I said. But the whoops problem involved $5.9 billion worth of debt. $2.3 billion is in 14% to 16% bonds. And there's a plan afoot to try to issue a new flotation of bonds this coming June or July to retire that high interest debt at 8% or 9%, something like that. That still leaves $3 billion worth of debt, which Ms. Paulus and I feel we should try to help lift from Mr. Jura's shoulders at the same time that the current Reagan budget advocates accelerating Bonneville's payback to the U.S. Treasury by some $500 million a year, which is both onerous and backbreaking and just inconceivable and not doable. I'm happy to report that Washington pundits say the Reagan budget is the most unnewsworthy item of the last week in Washington, D.C. So we've got to help Bonneville relieve its bonded indebtedness, help Whoops look at itself in a realistic mirror, which it is. It unveiled an action plan to us in the last 2 days. We've been meeting in Boise that was realistic, and it'll probably accelerate the functions of Whoops 2, which is a productive nuclear power plant, much as I might hate the modifying word. So we're trying to help that apparatus. Now, I'm a little over time. I've tried to codify my remarks to tell you basically what my part of the council is doing, and your job is to help by paying attention to the fact that we have an opportunity for danger or for progress. You have to help choose which path we shall follow.
Thank you. 1 month after I went on the council, and I was joined by another Republican, a man who had served for Senator McClure for 20 years as his chief of staff, and if you know Senator McClure, you can conclude from that my Republican counterpart wasn't in the liberal strain. But he and I were the only Republicans, and after a month of service, one of my brethren from Idaho came up to me and said, "You are the most liberal, the most bombastic, and the most outrageous public official I've ever known." One quarter hour after Ted's first performance, the same man came up to me, sidled by, and said, "Lady, you can't hold a candle to him." Now, let me talk to you about salmon. The life cycle, of the Pacific salmon, I think, is one of nature's more exquisite mysteries. And as most of you know, they are born in clear water streams, and they travel as many as 1,200 miles to the ocean. And along the way, they run a gauntlet of dams and predators. As they go downstream, they undergo what's called a smoltification process, which adapts them to salt water. Nature has timed their journey with the spring runoff, so they're supposed to make it to the sea in about 30 days. If they do not, the smoltification process reverses itself and they die in the estuary. Once in the ocean, these salmon travel thousands of miles, some to the Gulf of Alaska, some that are only left turning, which I used to think was a joke, down to the California coast. But depending on their stock, this journey lasts from 3 to 7 years. But finally, they return to the mouth of the Columbia, and through some incredible homing instinct, they travel unerringly to spawn and then die in exactly the same stream bed where they were born. When Lewis and Clark were on our scene, there were 16 million salmon that made that voyage up and down the Columbia River. And mind that I said up and down the river. The first commercial fishery went into operation in 1866. By 1918, the fish canneries on the Columbia had processed 3,700,000 fish annually. That is more than we're producing today. But since the 1930s, the salmon have faced their greatest threat, dams. There are about 75 dams that figure into our fish program in one way or another in the Columbia River. There are 10 on the main stem, only 8 of which we're dealing with. I'm going to leave the Grand Coulee and the Hell's Canyon to the next generation. So we're dealing with the 8 on the main stem, and the others come into play either through mitigation, screening, spill, or storage. In 1983, we met our lowest commercial catch, a modern low, 85,000 salmon a year. In 1986-88, it was increased to 1 million, and that's largely due to lower river hatcheries. In 1981, when Congress created the Power Council, in addition to charging us with the responsibility of coming up with a reasonable power plan, it also charged us with a program, coming up with a program to rebuild, mitigate, and protect the salmon and steelhead runs and wildlife. It is the largest effort in the nation, indeed one of the largest in the world, to reclaim a natural resource. The value of this resource cannot be calculated in dollars alone. It has cultural, recreational, and even religious values to the Northwest. But just in economic terms, in the state of Oregon alone, our economists in Oregon estimate that the income generated by sport and commercial fishing it goes slightly over $700 million annually. Now that is without a predictable salmon season. So the economic benefit to the region, if we can accomplish our goal, is very easy to see. Our goal, which was described by the council in 1983, I believe, is to double the runs. There is no time limit on it. And our plan to accomplish that goal integrates three approaches to survival. First one is to improve in the natural and artificial fish production. And I want to talk to you about that for just a minute. We must have hatcheries. There is no way to reach our doubling goal without hatcheries. But I feel strongly that we do not emphasize the natural or wild fish enough in our program. And I am personally, and I'm speaking just for myself, am trying to reemphasize the natural or wild fish. Much is unknown about the salmon. That's one of the things that I found the most startling of my service on the council. I thought we knew everything there was to know about fish. We know very little about the salmon. We know very little about its life cycle. We are attempting to coordinate that research, but I believe, as I said, that we should have greater emphasis on the wild fish. The reason that that's so important is because those fish carry very important gene pools that will be lost forever unless we save them. And the genetics provide biological diversity, disease resistance, which is increasingly important, different strengths such as the ability to make those long upriver runs. I fear that if we concentrate and go full bore just on the hatchery and forget about the wild fish, that we're going to end up with what I call fish wimps. And I don't know about how the rest of you feel about this, but I'm not into this, and I'm not putting as much effort as I am just to produce protein. I want to perpetuate the propagation of the wild wily salmon, as we've always known it, and as the Indians knew it. And it is my feeling that we cannot reach that goal unless we emphasize the wild fish and pay more attention to habitat. But as I said, nearly 70% of all the hatchery, or all the salmon and steelhead in the basin are hatchery produced. Now, the second thing that we want to do, in addition to the production end of it, is work on the passage on the main stem. And I'm surprised to find, as I go around and meet with groups, that most people think we solved the problem of getting the salmon up and down the river when we placed fish ladders. And we've done a good job of that. We do, however, still need improvements in fish ladders to get the adult fish up the river to spawn, because we are losing as much as 5 or 10% of the adult salmon as they go up. But that's not the biggest problem. The biggest problem we find are getting the small fish down the river once they've spawned. The problem is varied. Number one, the salmon has a genetic chip in it when it's born, which says now that you've spawned through the fry, fingerling, and smolt size, when it gets to be a smolt, its genetic chip says now you're going to enter this raging river and dash to the sea in the spring runoff, and you're going to make it in the 30 days. Well, now the salmon enters not a dashing, raging river, but a string of very placid pools. The salmon become disoriented. They're subjected to predation. The smoltification process is reversed if they don't make it. And then, of course, they go through the dams. They must go through the dams. Now, earlier this week, I was speaking to the Corps of Engineers. I first put the podium right against the wall. And I said that the dams were creating fish puree. And one man, an engineer, stood up and took me to task about that. He said, that is the wrong image for you to conjure up. When I read that in the paper, it made me so angry because you're placing this image in the public's mind that simply isn't accurate. The turbines are large, the smolt are small, the worst that happens to them is a few descaling episodes. Well, I don't want to waste your time arguing it. Let's just take judicial notice for today's involvement that going through 8 turbines is not my idea of aerobic exercise for fish. So. The first thing that the council did, and I think it was an extraordinarily, it was almost a divine consensus on a regional basis, they decided to create an artificial freshet to help the salmon in its downstream migration. And they established what's known as the water budget. And in a sense, it's nothing more than the storage of water, a block of water set aside to be called upon by the fish biologists during the spring migration to create a faster rush down the river and help. I think there should be a larger volume of water, but we do have a water budget. And the utilities, I think, have never gotten enough credit for that. It costs them money, and it's very important to our doubling goal. That was the first problem. The second problem was to screen the dams and build bypass systems. And we have made some progress in that, but we are running up against a stone wall, namely the Corps of Engineers. And let me tell you a little bit about that, because I think what has happened with the Corps and its obstruction to this plan is one of the more outrageous violations of the democratic process I've ever seen in 20 years of making public policy. The region, that means all of the Indian tribes, all of the Indian nations, utilities, public and private, fish biologists, 4 governors, 4 state fish and game commissions, all of the environmental groups, sporting groups, commercial fishery, all of those people got together, spent 2.5 years debating around a table how to solve this problem of the dams. The best scientific guess in the region said we must screen the dams and we must have bypass systems. After there was a regional consensus, that regional group went to Congress, and our congressional delegation, to a man in the 4 states, supported the effort. And Congress passed our proposal, which was to screen and bypass the dams, and placed money to start the process in the Corps' budget. The Corps thumbed its nose, not only at Congress, but every person in this region, and steadfastly refused to expend the money according to the direction by Congress. Senators Hatfield and McClure were so angered by this that they introduced a second bill which said, do what we've already told you to do. Now, to be fair about it, the Army Corps of Engineers could not have done this if we had not had a complicitous Office of Management and Budget in the Reagan administration. So it took a team effort to stop us from achieving that goal. The Corps has now said that it will do what Senators McClure and Hatfield have told them to do, but there is no present money in the budget, either from the Corps or in Congress, to proceed along the screening mechanism. And we are once more faced with this problem of going back to Congress and having more money appropriated and then doing battle with the Corps of Engineers. The utilities have supported us in the effort. All the public utilities and all the private utilities have joined this regional consensus. The reason primarily that they have supported the screening and bypass plan is because they know that until we do that, the only way we can get the fish through the dams is to take them literally over the dam and spill, and spill is extremely expensive. And if you spill water, you're not pushing it through turbines and making electricity to sell to California. So the utilities, I think, are to be complimented for coming to the bargaining table and assisting us on water budget, with the water budget and with the spill efforts and with the bypass screens. And we certainly need their continued support to beat the Corps into submission. Now, what does the Corps say it wants to do? The Corps wants to put fish on wheels or on barges. Now, that's not all bad. In low water years, we need transportation. And in some instances, it does work very well. It works very well for steelhead. But for reasons that we don't understand, it does not work for spring Chinook. And the spring Chinook is the king of the kings. In addition, we have already told the Corps that they can't barge or truck fish unless we have a mechanism to collect them. And you can't collect them without the screens and bypass. There is another factor that is also very important to me, and that is that if we proceeded the way the Corps wants to do it, the wild fish would be decimated at a higher rate than the hatchery fish, and over a period of time, the gene diversity would be destroyed, and you would end up with a very wimpy fish. So I think it's critical that we join forces again and bring the Corps to the bargaining table once again. And I have told them that I and the Council will listen to everything they say. We will participate. We will ask them to participate. And if they don't agree, then they have every right to go to Congress and plead their cause and tell the congressional delegation why their plan is better. But once Congress has decided, they have to follow that congressional edict. If not, it's simply a matter of the United States Army turning its back on civilian government, and I think it's a great abuse of the democratic process. On the spill, I would like to mention that we are trying at this very moment to seal a 10-year agreement with all of these entities so that each year during the migration period between April and June, we wouldn't be constantly battling over the spill. I don't think the amount of money or the amount of spill that we've agreed on is sufficient. And if I could, I would vote to increase it. But at least we have a plan that would save a great many fish if we could get it adapted. The Corps often refuses to spill the water according to our biologists' demands, and they often fail to release the water at the times when we feel it should be released. So we have a three-pronged battle there with the Army Corps of Engineers. Now, the question that I hope you, the public, you, the ratepayers, start to ask, I wish you'd wise up about this. The question you should ask, and you should ask it of the Council, and you should ask it of Bonneville, and most particularly the Corps of Engineers, how can we justify spending millions of ratepayer dollars propagating fish and getting them up the river to spawn only to allow half of your economic investment to be lost at the dams? And that's exactly what we're talking about. Hatcheries are enormously expensive. What good does it do to propagate them, get them to the adult stage, only to lose the smolts? It makes no economic sense. So I hope that you'll pay very particular attention to that. Now, harvest. Harvest is, of course, the most contentious issue. And I would ask this. I would say to everyone that's interested in this issue, and particularly those that are sports fishermen or commercial fishermen, that we have to put the harvest arguments behind and join together on production. If we don't, we're going to have all the fishermen, commercial and sport and Indians, down at the mouth of the Columbia, railing against each other and fighting over the last salmon. We must join forces and lay those old battles, put them behind us, and concentrate on production and worry about the harvest issues more after we've produced and know that we have a sustainable yield. And to the sports and commercial fishermen, I would say this. They fight. The sports fishermen fight among themselves, and all the sports fishermen fight against the gill netters. But all fishermen, commercial and sports, rail against the Indians. Let you know and let them know that it is the Indian that has the constitutional footing. It is the Indian that's got the legal footing to make this plan go. Indeed, if it were not for the Indians, we wouldn't have a fish program. We cannot do without the Indians. So bear that in mind as we go down this road. We've made a lot of progress, but so much more needs to be done. And we won't until you join forces with us to win our battle with the Corps of Engineers. Thank you.
Dick Tracy will ask the first question. You're certainly welcome to address your questions to either of our speakers or to both of them.
Thank you, Phil. One of the major issues facing our country and the electric power industry is the greenhouse effect, or global warming. How is the Council addressing this complicated issue in its planning?
Is that to me? On February 9th in Olympia, the Council is sponsoring its first, only to date, seminar to brief itself on the greenhouse effect. Our members attended recently a seminar sponsored by the natural gas producers in Portland, which was a very good thing. Dr. Michael Schlesinger of Oregon State University turns out to be one of the country's paramount authorities in the subject. So we're going to brief ourselves because I'm deeply concerned about the greenhouse effect. I accept the scientific data that says it's here. If we, you know, stop CO2 discharges tomorrow, we're still in way over our heads. So the question is, how can we avoid compounding the current deleterious effects? Other members of the Council are not yet so convinced. It is my hope that the seminar will help convince them, although I am well aware of the fact, as an anti-nuclear individual, that the nuclear industry is salivating at the prospect of all of us being so concerned about terminating CO2 emissions that we will turn to increased nuclear power generation as our savior, which I will consider our damnation, not our salvation.
No, I agree totally with Ted.
I'm Gregory Cafuri. Mr. Hallock has spoken of least cost planning, and that, by the law, applies to new energy sources. They have to prove that they're more efficient than, for instance, conservation. The question would be whether that same policy would be well applied to existing energy sources, and if that were to be done, and would you support it? Secondly, would you support factoring into that equation some quantification of risk so that when we look, for instance, at the Trojan plant, we see that, that one subsidy, which we all concede to it, is the risk of living in the shadow of the plant. Thank you.
Well, time's up. Goodbye. That's a marvelous question. That's exactly what I'm after. For example, if you didn't track Gregory, you have a coal plant that's going its merry way, Colstrip or Boardman if it was operating, discharging CO2 into the air. It's perfected some scrubbing apparatus for SO2, but it hasn't tackled CO2 at all. So if we compelled the coal operator to scrub, to deal with to terminate the CO2 emissions. And there's a scientific debate about the feasibility of that, but I suffice it that I buy the argument it can be done. But if we do that, and it costs this amount per kilowatt hour for dirty coal-produced power, and this amount for clean coal-produced power, I want coal looked at that basis realistically before we say we're going to indict solar that costs the same amount as clean coal. Now, nuclear. Senator Timothy Worth of Colorado has a bill in, among others, that would spend $750 million, which is really not much money in this arena, to clean up nuclear. Well, if he came up, God willing, with a clean fission or fusion plant that was just perfect, no problems at all, and today's nuclear cost this much per kilowatt hour, and that nuclear cost this much per kilowatt hour, where wind costs this much and solar costs this much and tidal costs this much, then I want nuclear looked at exactly in that economic line. So Mr. Kefouri is right on line. I want new formulae drafted. I want our staff to begin to look at what I'm going to call not the least costs, but the clean costs of operating acceptable coal, and if there is such a thing as acceptable nuclear. Then we'll look at the previously discriminated against renewable alternative sources of energy. Now, Norma may wish to add to that.
Ditto.
I'm Claire Pucci, City Club member and director of the Portland Audubon Society, and I would like to ask either one of you what the council is doing to address wildlife other than fish in your deliberations, since that is part of your charge also.
Yes, I wanted to talk about that, but I overrun my time limit. We are charged with coming up with a wildlife plan. We have been, for some months now, taking testimony or receiving information from the states on what their proposals are, and just yesterday had a hearing on this very issue. So we are entering into it, I think, with the idea that we have no preconceived notion of what the program should be. The utilities are urging us to do in the other three states what recently occurred in Montana, and that was to set up a trust fund for a mitigation for the Libby and Hungry Horse dams in Montana. And I think the utilities see that as something that they'll know won't go on indefinitely, and it's got a cap, and they can live with it and work it in the rate system. If we took everyone's wish list that has been submitted to us now, we would be looking at a $500 million expenditure, which more than likely would trigger a rate increase. And if there are those of you in the audience that have heard that from your lobbyists, let me tell you, as we told the people in Boise, we have made no decision, and we are in the process right now of receiving information, evaluating it. We have not fleshed out the program.
Ray.
I'm Ray Polani, a member of the City Club. Senator Hallock, I realize that this is probably not a power planning question, but you know, we hear so much about conservation, and invariably it ends up in better buildings, more efficient buildings, and maybe cogeneration for industrial plants and all of this. And if we talk about conservation in the transportation sector, which is very energy consuming, the only answer is generally makes the car more efficient. Can you tell me personally, why do you think that we never look at the alternatives in transportation, meaning rails and public transportation?
Because it takes a lot of courage to be a public official and seek elective office and to expose yourself to the slings and arrows of continuously outraged fortune. One of the many reasons I salute Ms. Paulus for her most recent endeavor and look back with horror at the five times that I exposed myself to public dissection in terms of running for the Senate. Remember when Frank Ivancy was mayor? Don't you think that typified it? Touch my electorates, motor cars, and I'll hang you by the you-know-what. You don't touch. It's like the ARA's lobbying against gun control. Two things you don't screw with in America. You don't fool with man's right to carry a good old gun, kill his neighbor, and second of all, to drive his motor car, singular or plural, as often, as fast, and wherever and however he wants to. Now, a realistic answer to your question is, of course, it occurred to me 3 months into my term, if I'm working on the minimal coal CO2 emissions, you know, 3% of our power supply or 2% provided from fossil fuel plants, what in the hell about the 8 million motor cars in Oregon, Washington, Idaho, and Montana that are spewing it out? So among the other things I did, I wrote to Fred Hansen, our very capable director of the Department of Environmental Quality, and asked if he, the governor, the legislature, wouldn't consider mandatory motor vehicle emission inspection in the other 33 or 32 counties we have it in the Tri-County area as one step. I personally, but this is me, I personally believe in a carbon tax, an extremely high tax, and hitting at the motor vehicle first. But then again, I can say that because I'm not running for public office. If you run for political office, you're executed with a remark, having uttered a remark like that. Motor car is sacrosanct. It's going to take politicians with the guts. In the old days, before she told me to not be a chauvinist, I would have said with the balls, but with the guts to take on the motor car. And to answer you, Ray, you're, that's the major offender. You're right on.
Thank you.
Hi, Tom Pansky, City Club member. Mrs. Paulus, I guess after Mr. Hallock's description of load resource balance coming our way in 3 or 4 years, I was wondering what your perception is of the political will of both the council and the region in sticking by your guns in the protected areas that you set aside for fish and wildlife habitat, and what pressures you see coming to either enhance or decrease that protection.
Well, first of all, my political judgment tells me that most of the residents in the Northwest, not just our state, but in the Northwest, would be very supportive of that effort. We have 2.6 million people in the state of Oregon. Our Wildlife Commission issues 2 million licenses every year, to give you some idea of how many Oregonians are involved in one way or another with the outdoors and wildlife. A month ago in Idaho, the Wildlife Commission had a wildlife congress expecting 200 people to show up. 1,000 showed up. The fact that Senator Hatfield's bill passed and that the Scenic Waterways Addition bill passed, the initiative passed in this state overwhelmingly, would lead me to believe that that we are not going to have more hydro development in the West. Now, most of the good hydro sites have already been utilized. There are, admittedly, smaller units out there. But if it ever comes to the point where we have to have them, I would just submit to you that it's much easier to change that prohibition than it is to remove a dam. So I see the region coming to grips with conservation. If we had MCS, maximum or model conservation codes, if for residential and commercial buildings in all four states, this region would save enough electricity that we wouldn't have to worry about bringing on new resources for at least 15 years, and it's the cheapest. One of the things that we have to do, which so far only PGE has done, and that is change the public's perception about what conservation of energy really means. It means energy efficiency. It does not mean deprivation or curtailment. Most people, when you say energy conservation, it conjures up an image of Jimmy Carter in his sweater shivering in front of a fireplace, telling us that we had to sacrifice. PGE, I think, has done us all a good favor with its ads, which convince us that you get warm and fuzzy feelings by living in a warm house. And so I see the region finally coming to grips with conservation, and that will be the number one thing. And then we will be exploring, while we're doing that, the other renewables.
Thank you.
I have a written question addressed to Ted Hallock. With all the problems of power production from nuclear coal dams and so forth, why doesn't the state of Oregon really encourage the exploration and development of the large geothermal resources in the state rather than just giving it lip service?
Well, part of the indictment is justifiable and part of it is not. Most of the lands upon which there could be geothermal drilling in the state of Oregon are owned by or controlled by the federal government. Mahar County, Harney County, Lake County, in the case of the 100,000 acres that are being drilled on under a lease arrangement near Crater Lake that are the environmental, in the center of this environmental hassle, they're federally owned. I believe that's the same in the Crook Deschutes Jefferson County area. In the legislature, almost 18 years ago, through our state geologist and our land board, which comprised the top three state officials and so forth, I did everything possible to encourage our state to stimulate and allow drilling, in spite of the fact that it was then and still remains, to a degree, a controversial subject. But the laggards, or the laggard agency, is the BLM. And the BLM right now has got the Crater Lake application under its appellate procedure, where it may take another year and a half. So the question is, I suppose, well directed to Governor Goldschmidt to urge the national director of the BLM to get going and to expedite a decision in the Crater Lake matter and then to move with more rapidity thereafter. But Oregon isn't really much of a player in that field.
I think we have time for one final question. The electric utility industry, like the telecommunications and airlines, appears headed towards some form of deregulation and diversification. What are the council's views on current trends in the industry, and how does the power plant take these factors driving such changes into account?
Well, first of all, I don't know whether Ted mentioned it or not, but as far as the surplus is concerned, most of the surplus that we presently have in the region is on the public side. In other words, is in Bonneville. The region, the four states, are served 48% by Bonneville's power, and which is almost entirely hydro, and then 52% by the private, or IOUs, investor-owned utilities. The investor-owned utilities are looking at a lot of options, but they've convinced me that while the council sits and talks about big coal-fired plants as being in our future, that's not going to happen, that we're going to have smaller bites of energy, and they're looking a lot to cogeneration. We're trying to find out, learn more about cogeneration and just exactly how much there is in the region, but there is a lot. So I think that it's absolutely critical that the region address this issue and bring the private utilities, make sure that they come to the bargaining table so that the public knows exactly what they're relying on too and what they're projecting for their load growth and how they intend to meet it. We must know that. While the Bonneville power, the publics have a preference for that power, it's a political reality that if when I live in Salem and am served by PGE and my neighbor is served by a public utility, Salem Electric, if my lights go off, somehow, politically, this region would have to come to grips with that, and the private utilities would eventually get some of the Bonneville power. So that is a great area of concern, of course, for the public utilities. So I would hope that we can find a mechanism to have the private utilities brought out into a public discussion of this. Our PUC commissions now in all of the states are demanding least cost planning plans from the private utilities, and they are engaged in preparing and submitting them. So I think that we are reaching that point where we will have a public scrutiny of this, and the public can help make the choice.